great deal of the philosophy that's going on today in the English-speaking world, in fact, probably most of it, can be traced back through intermediate developments to the work of two men, Gottlob Frege and Bertrand Russell. Working for the most part independently of each other, they laid the foundations of modern logic. But more than that, although the work on which they began concerned chiefly the principles of mathematics and the relationship between mathematics and logic, its implications went so wide that in the course of time it came to have a profound influence on philosophy in general. Exactly the same happened with the philosopher who most obviously and directly followed on from them, namely Wittgenstein. Wittgenstein started by developing Russell's and Frege's work in mathematical logic, but he ended up acquiring an influence at large on 20th century philosophy, which is second to nobody's. In this programme, without going into any of the technicalities of mathematics or logic, I want to give some indication of how Frege and Russell came to have this enormous influence on 20th century thought, and to say a little about some of the more recent individuals and groups who've come under that influence. But first, a word about the individuals themselves. Frege, a German, was born in 1848 and spent his entire working life in comparative obscurity in the mathematics department of the University of Jena. Not until after his death did his name become known at all widely, even among philosophers. His first major work, published in 1879, was called Begriffsschrift, and I'm afraid even the English translation keeps the German title because there's no satisfactory English for it. It means something like the putting of concepts into notation, and we'll begin to see later what that's about. His next major work, published in 1884, is called in English The Foundations of Arithmetic. He went on producing important and original work, most notably in 1893 and 1903, two volumes of a projected larger work called in English The Basic Laws of Arithmetic. But it was all of such depth and difficulty that his work in general remained very largely unknown until Bertrand Russell drew attention to it in 1903. Russell was a totally different sort of person, grandson of a British Prime Minister, from whom he was later, via his elder brother, to inherit an earldom. He was always prominent on the political and social scene as well as in philosophy, in fact a famous public figure all his life. He did a tremendous amount of popular writing and journalism and broadcasting, which influenced social attitudes among successive generations of British people. I think this has obscured for many the fact that the true foundations of his fame as a philosopher lie in contributions to mathematical logic of a highly professional and technical character. He was born in 1872 and lived till 1970 and was politically active almost to the end, though the great bulk of his philosophical work was done by the 1920s. Here to discuss the work of these two men and some of its influences down to our own day is one of the most famous philosophers of our time, A.J. Ayer, who has written a great deal about Russell, including the best short introductory book on Russell's work. Professor Ayer, let's start with Frege as being the earlier figure. When he began, what was it he was trying to do?
Well, he was trying to make up what he thought were the deficiencies in arithmetic. He thought that mathematical statements, as they were expressed in his day, were not sufficiently precise and that mathematical proofs were not sufficiently rigorous. And so he began by trying to develop a notation, the Begriffsschrift you referred to, in which this would be remedied. And the notation was to show exactly what mathematical statements stated and exactly what their proofs consisted in. It was supposed to make it obvious how one step in a proof succeeded another. And this was a deficiency in mathematics in his time, applying even to Euclid, where there were assumptions not made explicit which were required for the proofs to be valid.
Wasn't one of the points involved that every argument, including a mathematical proof, has to have premises, and what those premises are often creates problems? And he tried to show that all mathematics was ultimately derived from pure principles of logic.
Exactly. Both he and Russell did this, and this involved two enterprises. First of all, defining mathematical concepts in purely logical one, and secondly, showing that mathematics, arithmetic anyhow, not all mathematics, but arithmetic, was deducible from purely logical premises. And this was achieved, the first part was achieved fairly simply, I think a fairly simple illustration will show how it was done. If you take, let's say, any couple, let's take Tom and Jerry, then you can define them as a couple by saying that they are both members of the set, and anything which is a member of the set is identical with one or other of them. Then you define the number two as a set of such sets, a set of couples. And you do this for all numbers. And there are certain complications about infinity, but in this way, you can define a cardinal number in purely logical terms, which is what he did. And then also, by generalizing logic, which hadn't hitherto been done, Aristotelian logic, which had prevailed from ancient times until the 19th century, was not wholly general. He was able to state premises from which most arithmetic was deducible. It was shown later by somebody, by another logician, the Austrian Gödel, that in fact this couldn't be completely done, that arithmetic couldn't be completed, but that insofar as it could be completed, Frege shared a method of doing it.
Wouldn't it also be true to say that before Frege, the laws of logic had been regarded as laws of thought, that's to say, as something to do with human mental processes. But Frege realized that this couldn't be so, that the validity of a proof couldn't depend on our psychology.
Oh, yes, this was very important. This was one of the most important things that Frege did, and he began by one of his early works was an attack on a book on arithmetic by a German philosopher called Husserl, in which logic was represented as a theory of judgment. And this was how it was viewed by the German idealists, and Frege insisted it was entirely objective, had nothing to do with psychological processes, but that the sets in which he reduced numbers were entirely objective things, and that logic was quite independent of wasn't about psychology at all, that these were objective truths, which, of course, the mind is capable of grasping. They didn't depend upon features of thinking.
Yes. So the search then becomes, in a mathematical proof, for what it is that the proof conveys from step to step.
That's right.
That impersonally validates the conclusion,
right,
regardless of how we think.
And this, in a way, accounts for Frege having a philosophical interest beyond his purely mathematical work, because he also developed a theory of meaning, a theory of meaning which would show how mathematics could be objectively valid. And he talked of the... he tied up the meaning of mathematical statements, but this could be extended to statements in general, with truth conditions, with the features in them that made them candidates for truth or falsehood.
I suppose the most historically influential distinction that he introduced was the distinction between sense and reference,
mm-hmm.
Which has to do with his theory of meaning, and one still hears people constantly referring to this. Can you explain it?
Yes, it's fairly complicated. The two German expressions are Sinn, which is generally translated sense, and Bedeutung, which is translated, which is in fact the German word for meaning, but is by philosophers usually translated as either reference or denotation. And the denotation of a name is the object to which it names. I mean, the denotation of Bryan Magee is you, the actual person.
Yes.
Whereas the sense of the name is the contribution that it makes to the meaning. And say, if I just say Tom, you have to say to me, who's Tom? And then I say, well, Tom is so-and-so's brother, and or the person who invented such and such, or the first person that climbed up the mountain. And in this way, I give you a sense, and in this way, I enable you to identify him. Now, this distinction becomes important in certain contexts. Generally, what you care about in the case of a name is what the name stands for. But there are certain cases where it's important to make a distinction between sense and denotation. And one good example would be statements of identity. The Frege's own favorite example was that of the evening star and the morning star, both of which, as you know, are
in fact
Venus.
The same star.
Same
yes.
star, Venus.
Yes.
And but if someone says the evening star is identical with the morning star, and one takes the reference of these two expressions to be the denotation, then he's simply saying Venus is Venus, which is a tautology and of no interest, whereas in fact the morning star and the evening star is a mathematical discovery. And therefore, in this usage, what the expressions refer to is not their denotation, not the object, but their senses.